This is Place de la République in Paris, where France commemorates the loss of 130 people killed in last month's terrorist attack. My guest today has his own recent experience of terrorism. He's one of Tunisia's most prominent politicians, Mohsen Marzouk, General Secretary of the President's party, Nidaa Tounes. With rising violence at home, political infighting, and widespread human rights abuses, is Tunisia's revolution heading finally for catastrophic failure? Mohsen Marzouk, welcome to Conflict Zone.
Thank you for having me here.
Three major terrorist incidents, the last one just a few days ago. An assassination attempt, major assassination attempt. You've called this a war. Are you losing this war now?
No. I mean, we are starting this war. It's starting having this war. What we need is to consider it as a war and to conduct it as a war with the means of the war, with the rationale of the war. So it needs also cooperation at the international level, at the regional level.
Well, you've had cooperation at international level. You've had huge sums of money given to Tunisia. You've had massive assistance of at least $3.5 billion over the last 5 years.
Related to security issues, no. I mean, related to the whole, let's say, problems of the country, economic problems, social problems.
And you've got loan guarantees from Washington. Washington is supplying you with helicopters.
It's a loan guarantee. And the helicopters will arrive by 2019, so we didn't get the helicopters yet. And we are now in 2015. The issue is when you're talking about the international cooperation, mainly not bilateral cooperation only. We need multilateral cooperation, mainly on the issues of intelligence and information sharing. And the world needs this, not only Tunisia. All the countries who are now conducting this war and who should assume this war.
Yeah, your problems, though, are at home. They're not with the international community, are they? You said yourself, the problem is your own mafia inside Tunisia. Fighting terrorism is very difficult, especially because we have mafia lobbies linked to terrorism. Those were your words.
Yes.
So why aren't you doing anything about them?
I mean, we are trying. We are starting this. In all the democracy transition processes, all the countries who went through this process, there is moments where the state are weak because we are rebuilding.
So you're weak at the moment?
Of course. I mean, it's a democratic transitional process. So, I mean, the state institutions are weak because you are building new institutions. In these moments, in general, you have these kind of lobbies and you can't have that mafia.
Well, hang on a minute, because you said we must expose the relationship between the mafia corruption,
yes,
the generals in the police force, and terrorism. So you're saying that your own police force is involved with this mafia.
I didn't say that. This wasn't very, let's say, I mean, I know this report. I didn't say that. I was in Washington and I said that.
Yes,
if
it was reported
we do not,
31st yes, of October in Al-Sharouk.
Al-Sharouk, it wasn't really very accurate. What they said is if we do not find mafia, then they may have an impact on the police, on the security, and all the army, and all the institutions of the state. The link between smugglers and terrorists is clear. I mean, on the frontiers, let's say, zones and the border zones.
Well, if it's clear, shut it down.
We are working on this. It's not easy at all. I mean, because, I mean, these are, let's say, networks. 50% of the Tunisian economy is an informal economy. But, well, this is one element, one component of the whole issue, one factor. There is different factors. First, we are Tunisia in the region.
So do you know who these mafia lobbies are?
Some,
this is my question.
Some of
do
them,
you
we
know
know, we know some of them.
Okay, then who are
we
they?
We have
who
to investigate.
They?
We have to
who
investigate.
They?
But then they are not...
You don't want to tell me who they are. You say you know who they are, but you're not going to tell me who they are.
I mean, it's the police has to do this. It's not my job. I mean, I'm a politician. This is, people have to investigate in this.
Yeah, but well, the police but are then, either competent or corrupt, aren't they?
They are trying to understand what is happening, to adapt themselves, because it's war, it's an asymmetric war. They were not trained for this. And then these lobbies are not only based in Tunisia, they're based in Tunisia, they're based also in the neighboring countries. The whole region is going through a difficult time. So Tunisia cannot win a war, which is at the regional level.
Okay, well, maybe your police force would do more about the mafia lobbies if it wasn't beating people up in the prisons, torturing them, as they've been doing during the old regime. Maybe they'd have more time to go after your mafia lobbies, wouldn't they?
I don't think that this is what exactly what's happening. What is happening is that the police is going through the same, and Tunisia is going through the same debate. about the relationship between fighting terrorism and protecting the rights. It happens here in France. It happens in the UK. It happens in the United States with the Patriot
Act. No, it's a bit different. Come on. I mean, we have human rights lawyer Radia Nasrawi saying that electric shocks are being used in jail. Rape is being used in your jails. This savagery, she says, is still going on. Human Rights Watch said several deaths in custody occurred in 2013. This isn't just a normal process.
This is not
your
normal
police
process.
Are beating people up, torturing them, and raping them in your jails.
Do you think that, I mean, we can have a new police after a revolution in 2 or 3 years? It's a long process. They have to be trained. These people have to go through a process when the rule of law is enforced.
So it's so difficult to stop beating people up and torturing them with electric shocks. Is it so difficult to stop that?
I don't think that is systematic. These are individual acts. And what even Mrs. Nasrawi is saying, that this is not happening in all the police posts in Tunisia. It happens in some of them. But it's very difficult to fight terrorism.
So do you know which ones it's happening in?
Yes, I mean...
So why don't you stop it?
We are stopping them. We are investigating. The parliament is investigating. The political parties are investigating. And the
well,
political...
Well, it's taking a long time,
the political
willing.
It's not a long time.
The UN Special Rapporteur noted last year very little action by prosecutors and judges in pursuing complaints of torture. Very little action. Why?
There is a lot of actions, and I was myself part of some of this action. But when we are conducting war against terrorism, it's very difficult to reform, because now we have a balance. First, we have to conduct this war against terrorism, and then we have to reform our security institutions.
Yeah, but the fact that this torture is going on, Mr. Marzouk, is a massive betrayal of the revolution, because the revolution was supposed to stop this practice.
I don't think
it was widespread.
I still think that this is not a systematic, let's say, thing, action happening, and I think that the political will in the country is against this action and against these practices, and that we are making a lot of progress at this level. But at the same time, it's very difficult to finish reforming the security, let's say, institutions in only 2 or 3 years. It will need some time. If we didn't have this war against terrorism, I'm sure that we'll gain time and we'll reform them in a very short, let's say, period.
Well, who's blocking these reforms?
The reforms?
Why are they taking so long?
They cannot be implemented in 1 year. I mean, you have the law, but then in order to train these people on this law, to create the institutions of control, then that will ensure that these people are really respecting human rights, it will take some time. Because these people were, let's say, practicing what they know during, let's say, 30 or 40 years in Tunisia.
Mr. Marzouk, you're a powerful man. You're a powerful politician. Uh-huh. Your general secretary was the largest party. If you can't use your influence to do this, what's the point in having a revolution?
Democracy transition is not, let's say, decision or political will only. It's a long-term
this is transition.
Process.
This is going backwards to the old days.
No.
This
sorry.
Is going backwards. That you're still having these accusations of
it's
basic
because,
human rights
it's not
abuses.
Because one lawyer said this, that...
It's not one lawyer. It's the UN Special Rapporteur. It's Human Rights Watch. It's Amnesty International.
Even,
it's a major human rights
even,
organization.
I mean, we are making a lot of progress, and there is a lot of reports who are saying that the political will is there. But the problem is that we are having this war against terrorism, and it's very difficult in this context of war, I mean, to have not only, let's say, to reform the security forces, even to reform the, let's say, the economic institutions. The Tunisia model has this particularity. First, we are going through a political transition process, which is weakened. Let's say the state institutions. Secondly, we have a very high level of expectations and social demands. And third, we have to conduct a war against terrorism. Three, let's say, major challenges at the same time. So
all right.
It's not easy.
Let's talk about the war on terrorism first and come to the other subjects that you mentioned. Did you miss warnings that were there before the attack on Sousse in June? Did you miss key warnings there?
I think it's no, I don't think, I mean, it's...
You fired the governor, you fired the police chief.
It's a war, yes, of course, because they were not, let's say, at the level of their duties. I mean...
Whose fault's that?
Look what happened in France, let me say, a few days ago. So can we say that, you know, the France, this happened because France, you know, didn't have, let's say, very nice the police organized and security forces.
Okay, but here was a clear warning. Here was a clear warning in March from a group calling itself Ajnad al-Khilafa, okay? And they said to the Christians, planning their summer vacations in Tunisia. We can't accept you in our land while your jets keep killing our Muslim brothers. But if you insist on coming, then beware, because we're preparing something for
this
you.
Is not
the warning could not have been clearer,
each
could it?
Each day they are could saying it? This. Each day they say maybe three or four, let's say, kind of the warning like that. But well, there is a beach, a long, let's say...
So nobody took it seriously. So the result was there was no security on the beach.
There was security on the beach, but unfortunately, when this guy decided to do this, I mean, in, let's say, 50 minutes, you have enough time. You cannot put a policeman and the gunman in front of all, let's say, this was the situation. But now we adapt ourselves for this kind of attacks.
And why did you close down 80 mosques immediately after this attack? If the mosques were a problem before the attack, why didn't you close them down before the attack? Why wait until afterwards?
We are closing down a lot of them because there is debate that happens between these people who are saying these are our liberties, and that as you may notice, even for the mosque, there is debate about the liberties.
They were inciting violence or they weren't.
When you are having democracy, when you have the new institutions, then you have to spend some time doing this. It's not, if you are a dictator, you can just say, I will do it and it happens. But in a democracy, and especially in this, newly created democracy, then you have the parliament to make a new law, then you have the judges to implement them.
You're giving me all these reasons why it takes so long. Why people aren't doing what they're supposed to be doing.
The Ministry of Religious Affairs said there is 80 mosques who are out of the control of the state. So does it mean that all these mosques were against, or let's say, against the state?
But
or
you
let's
knew
say,
which ones. You knew yes, which yes, ones and, to go to. And you could have gone to them before the attack
70,
if they were a problem.
70 or 75 were closed down in Mohsen this moment.
Why did you have more people going from Tunisia to join Islamic State than any other countries? More than 3,000 so far. Why is your youth
because
getting
you are
radicalized
the, because
to that extent?
The unique country which is giving the real digits. Some of the countries are not saying what is happening. I mean, you know how
which
many
countries
people...
are not saying what's happening?
Well, I mean, a lot of countries who are there.
Which?
You know, I mean,
which?
Caucasian, which? Gulf countries, African countries.
So you're saying you're not the main supplier?
I mean, well, we are.
You
maybe
are a main supplier, obviously.
Europe is having 3,000, I think, and we have 3,000. So I mean, there is some kind of balance.
Europe as a whole, not just one country.
Well,
Europe is not sending. Look, I mean, the figures are high.
Yeah.
As one of the student leaders said in Kairouan, let's be honest, 80% of Tunisian youths are on the path to militancy. They know it.
I think that this kind
the
of...
The students
say,
know it. You should know it too, shouldn't
this,
you?
This kind of reports, I mean, there is a lot of reports and there is a lot of rumors about that. What happens is that Tunisia, during this, let's say, 3 years of democracy transition, everything was open up. So, I mean, any person can come, you know, and let's say, recruit people. It wasn't, let's say, a choice of individuals. It was lobbies of recruitment, networks of recruitment. In 2012 and 13, the people who were ruling the country were not really tough enough against this kind of
You're talking
phenomena.
About the Islamist party.
Yes, sure. I mean, and we have an evidence. Since 2014, 2015, I mean, the people who are joining ISIS from Tunisia, I mean, the number is by dozens now. So, I mean, Tunisia
is not... Well, you
could
have made your point at the time. You could have criticized
them. Yes, of
course. You could have told them.
We criticized them, and there was demonstrations against them, and this was one of the main issue that was used even in the election campaign, that when you were ruling the country, you didn't do enough to stop this phenomena.
Mr. Marzouk, your situation, you're fighting a war, you said, so the country is facing a critical emergency. Why go in for political infighting in your own party? Different factions now beating each other up with sticks and insulting each other. What use is that to the country? How does that help your country?
It doesn't help the country, but well, I mean, it's not also a matter of choice, of individual choices.
So why not wait until the country is in a better position before you settle your political
scores? I would be very happy
in Nidaa Tounes.
I would be very happy to wait, but in general, in politics, you cannot control everything. And
your general secretary of the party, under you, the party has split into factions. It's your responsibility that it's split into factions, isn't it?
The issue started before I became secretary general.
You're in the same party and you're beating each other up with sticks. What kind of example does that set to the rest of the country?
Well, it happens once, you know. I mean, it wasn't between the militants of the people. It happened between the guards, different guards of, let's say, of
the And one meetings. Faction belongs to you and the other faction belongs to the president's son. Why don't you call a halt in the interests of national unity and devote your energies to actually making Tunisia a more secure place instead of settling your political scores?
First, you know, I mean, it wasn't, let's say, a faction that belongs to me. And to belongs to the president's son. It was, let's say, debate within the party because we are going to Congress, to convention, the first convention of the party. And secondly, after the last terrorist attack, we have decided to find different ways. Unfortunately, what is happening in Nidaa Tounes is not something that belongs only to the dynamic of Nidaa Tounes, but happens also to different, let's say, impact of dynamics and lobbies around the party. And so it's more complicated than we think.
Well, I don't think I know what you mean by that, but one of your members who resigned, Sabrine Goubatini, said there's no democracy in Nidaa Tounes. That's her complaint. You're general secretary of the party. It's up to you to ensure there is democracy.
Which is my complaint also.
It's your job. Your complaint, it's your job.
Which is because the issue, the debate is about the convention itself, and the Secretary General of Nidaa Tounes is not responsible to organize the convention. I think that we need to have election for this convention. I think we need to have democracy. Some people in the party think that democracy is not now, let's say, a priority.
Is that the president's son's faction?
Yes, and that's why we are having this problem now.
Well, he accuses you of wanting to be president. That's what all this is about.
I don't think it's an accusation.
You may not be thinking about it now, this minute, but do you want to be president?
It may be a possibility, why not? I mean, if you are making politics, you think you become a minister or prime minister, head of municipality, head of state. But, you know, it's not your envy. It should be, let's say, the result of an action. So now I'm not thinking at it as a priority now, but I don't think that ambition is something that politicians are not, let's say, thinking about.
But if that's the direction you're heading in, how important will it be to combat corruption in your government? Because you said you're on a transition, and a transition to democracy. Actually, you're getting worse in some sectors, like corruption. Tunisia dropped 20 places in the Transparency International Corruption Index between 2010 and 2014. The World Bank says it's costing you 2% of GDP, mm-hmm. your corruption. You're going backwards on corruption. Why?
I think that for fighting corruption should be a priority in Tunisia. Fighting corruption, fighting terrorism.
It may be a priority.
Reforming.
I'm asking you why it's going backwards, though.
Because the state is weak. In democracy transition processes, we are rebuilding all the institutions. So then you go through a period where the state is weak. And where the state is weak, the non-state actors, like lobbies of corruption, I mean, they have time to develop themselves.
But those who are charged with combating corruption are not getting the political assistance they need. In October, Lazhar Akremi, who was the minister in charge of relations with parliament, he resigned in protest at the spread of corruption. What he said was, I tried to combat corruption, but what is painful is that I was defeated. Defeated by whom?
I think that people didn't hear him or listen to him when he was saying that we have to fight corruption. And I'm also joining him as Secretary General of Nidaa Tounes to say that fighting corruption should be, let's say, a priority as fighting, let's say, terrorism. I don't think that now we are doing what we should do. I don't think that we are fighting corruption as we should do.
Well, the National Anti-Corruption Commission says the civil service is holding it hostage. Civil service is not allowing it to do what it needs. They've got a limited budget after a long fight, and the staff are being removed one by one. You say exactly. You're one of the most influential politicians in Tunisia.
Yeah.
I keep coming back to this. If you can't stand up and shout about this and get something done, who can?
We are shouting about that. But, you know, I mean, the government, you have a coalition of political parties. And as I've said, now in Tunisia, because it's democracy, it's not, I mean, because you are influential and you shout that things are
being
done.
Democracy. If
you need
key,
time.
If key things,
then you need, for
key
example,
abuses are going on.
Yeah.
And all the attempts to move forward are being blocked. If you take the Truth and Dignity Commission, for instance, plenty of evidence that attempts are underway to block its activities.
I think that they have their own problems inside, let's say, in this commission. So it's not because, I mean, some people are blocking them. Even for the, let's say,
the police prevented them from getting archives from the presidential palace, which they were promised.
No, I was there in the palace.
Siham Ben Zedrin, she said, my task is to dismantle the system and reform it, but I do not even have the right to investigate the cause of the massive violations.
I was in the palace when she was making her request, and we told her she can make copies, but then she have to give us very concrete demands. I don't think that they are enough professional. And because it's
well, why was she appointed if she's not professional?
It has been elected by the parliament. It's all these people are human rights, let's say, activists. There was a lot of resignation from her commission, four, I think, or five, or nine. So they are having their own problems. It's not, let's say, the matter of political willing. The political willing in Tunisia now is to fight corruption, is to fight terrorism. But then in order to transform our political willing to action, I think that there is a problem of time and there is a problem of, I will say, we are not adapted enough to this
situation. And you're continuing to crack down on journalists in a way that doesn't give the outside community any confidence whatsoever. The Committee to Protect Journalists has criticized new legislation that could be used, it says, to silence the media. It says the security services, we're back to them again, are harassing journalists who are critical of them and threatening them. Well, so much for the move to democracy. I mean, you told the Americans that Tunisia is a democracy, that you're joining the club, the democratic club.
Sure.
Not with these methods, you're not.
I mean, baby,
which club are you joining?
Well,
it's not democracy if you're harassing and intimidating journalists.
Police abuse is happening also in the United States, and there is a lot of debate in the United States about that. So I mean, in each.
This is a little more systematic than that, isn't it?
I think that in what happens in the United States at the moment, we're considered by some, let's say, activists as systematic. But what we are trying.
They're not arresting
Tunisia,
bloggers, you know, because they criticize the Ministry of Defense.
How many bloggers you have arrested? And these people who have been arrested, two or three. They were not criticizing the Minister of Defense. They were, let's say, making apology to terrorism. And now, if we are fighting terrorism, we have to be serious. So, I mean, there is a lot of reports. How many bloggers?
One of them, December 2014, blogger Yassin Ayari was convicted of defaming the army.
Yes, he is
defaming the army.
He is defaming the army, and he is, let's
he's
say...
He's not allowed to criticize the army.
It's not an issue of criticism on the army or based on what he's doing. But then if we are fighting terrorism, the people who are, let's say, encouraging terrorism or making apology to terrorism, we have to stop them. This is part of the whole war against terrorism. And the terrorism is not only the people who are killing, let's say, other people. Terrorism, let's say, is different lobbies, different circles, and at one circle there is people who are finding, let's say, some argument and encouraging this kind of actions. So I don't think that this is systematic. It's a lot of individual actions, and the political will is to stop this, but it will take time because it's not easy to move from an authoritarian regime who lasts for 100 years to, let's say, in 3 or 4 years, to a new paradise.
Mr. Marzouk, it's not an issue of stories.
In the meantime, though,
while you're moving, the population is becoming increasingly disillusioned, continuing dissatisfaction with the revolution. A year ago, those who thought democracy preferable to other systems had dropped below 50%. In reality, much lower. Asked if democratic government, if they wanted a democratic government or a strong leader to solve Tunisia's problems, only 38% chose the government. 59% voted for a strong leader. This means they want a dictator back again. What an indictment of your revolution, isn't it? They want a dictator back again.
This is what the people are trying to say. I mean, because they think that...
Because they're so dissatisfied with what you and the other politicians have done.
Because we are trying, you know, let's say, to impose the rule of law, because we think that... They think that we are not enough tough in fighting against, let's say, people. They think that liberties, some of them think liberties explain what is happening in the country, including terrorism and the issue of the lack of security. We think that democracy and freedom is an arm, is a weapon against terrorism. And we think that people, of course, I mean, because in 3 years they think that paradise will arrive at the social level.
No, 72% think the country is heading in the wrong direction.
Yes, in the wrong direction. Yes, I mean
they're not expecting paradise. They just want it to move in the right direction.
I was talking about the issue of liberties, because what we're saying The people are asking for less liberties and more security because of the terrorism war. We have to war against terrorism. So, it's, as I've said, it's complicated. So, some bloggers are saying, well, there is not enough liberties, and the majority of public opinion say you have enough liberties and we need dictatorship back because then it will help us fight against terrorism. So, it's not easy. It's complicated.
Mr. Marzouk, it's a transition.
Welcome to a transition.
I know you're telling me that things are not easy, but a lot is riding on Tunisia. You're the last chance of an Arab state to prove that it can have a democracy. If you fail, then the world will have the conclusion that Arabs can't do democracy.
We will not fail. Now it's...
You are failing.
No, we are not failing, I'm sorry to... I mean, we will not fail, but if you compare our model to the other models, we are more challenged than all the other waves of democracy that happened since the 70s, in South, let's say, South Europe or Eastern European countries or Africa or Latin America countries. As I've said, we have political challenges, social challenges, and also we have this war against terrorism. And we are not master of our fate in this war against terrorism because things are happening from the neighboring country and from the region. So even if you clean up in our country, then the danger will arrive from, let's say, the region itself. But we will succeed to give the Arab young people and to give to this region the first model of democracy. But then also our friends have to help us.
Mohsen Marzouk, thanks for being on Conflict Zone.